Well, good morning everybody, and welcome to St. Mary's Handley for our service of morning prayer this morning. I hope you enjoy the service, which will begin in a couple of minutes. Joining us online, though not in person this morning, though I have to say it is a bit of a surreal experience standing here inside St. Mary's completely empty on my own, but I do know that you're all out there and we are worshipping together in spirit and in truth wherever we are this morning. Now, of course, if there was, it's odd to say that there is actually an advantage to this because we are in lockdown and the churches are closed and there's only myself here. It does mean that we can sing some hymns this morning, which is really great. And I hope you've managed to print off the hymn sheet that was sent out earlier in the week. And we're going to begin with that now by singing our first hymn, All People That On Earth Do Dwell.
Joy.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. God is the Creator and Redeemer of all. O come, let us worship. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins. By the power of the Holy Spirit, we may give ourselves to the service of God. So let us just spend a moment or two in silent reflection as we prepare to bring those times we have fallen short of God's will and purposes for us. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Let us confess our sins. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from all our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore to us the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And may the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins, restore you in his image, to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song will we praise our God. Blessed are you, Lord, our God, creator and redeemer of all. To you be glory and praise forever. From the waters of chaos you drew forth the world, and in your great love fashioned us in your image. Now through the deep waters of death you have brought your people to new birth by raising your Son to life in triumph. May Christ your light Let us heartily rejoice in the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving and be glad in him with songs. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have come, let us worship and bow down and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God. We are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would listen to his voice and harden not your hearts at Meribah or on the day at Manasseh in the wilderness, when your forebears tested me and put me to the proof, though they had seen my 40 years long I detested that generation and said, this people are wayward in their hearts. They do not know my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Come, let us worship. Our psalm set for today, which can be found on the red reading sheet, and that's Psalm 90. Satisfy us by your loving kindness, so shall we rejoice and be glad. Lord, you have been our refuge from one generation to another. Before the mountains were brought forth, all the land and the earth were born. From age to age, you are God.
turn us back
to the dust and say, go back, O child of earth. For 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, and like a watch in the night.
You sweep us away like a dream. We fade away suddenly like the grass. In the morning it is green and flourishes. In the evening it is dried up and withered. For we consume away in your displeasure. We are afraid because of your wrathful indignation. Our iniquities you have set before you, and our secret sins in the light of your countenance. When you are angry, all our days are gone. We bring our years to an end like a sigh. The span of our life is 70 years, perhaps in strength even 80. Yet the sum of them is but labour and sorrow, for they pass away quickly, and we are gone. Who regards the power of your wrath? Who rightly fears your indignation? So teach us to number our days,
that we may apply our hearts to wisdom.
Satisfy us
by your loving kindness, so shall we rejoice.
Glory to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is
now, and shall be forever. Amen.
So we come to our first reading for today, which is from the first
letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 5, verses 1 to 11.
Concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters,
you do not need to have anything written for you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will
come like a thief in the night.
When they say there is peace and security, then suddenly destruction will come upon them, as labour pains come upon a pregnant woman. And there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not for that day to
surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day.
We are not of the night
or the darkness.
So then let us not
fall asleep as others do.
But let us keep awake
and be sober.
For those who sleep, sleep at night. And those who are
drunk, get drunk at night.
But since we belong to the day,
let us
and put on the
breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation.
For God has destined
us not for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ,
who died for us,
so that whatever we are, awake, asleep, we may live with him.
Therefore, encourage one another,
and build up each other, as indeed you are doing.
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So picking up on that theme of discipleship and following the Lord and being encouraged, we come to our next hymn now, Will You Come and Follow Me?
Thank you.
some hymns again. But let us move now to our Gospel reading for today, which is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25, verses 14 to 30. Jesus said to his disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. The one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And the one who with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, "Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I've made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, "Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours." But his master replied, "You wicked and lazy slave. You knew that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have in abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to Christ our Lord. We come to the responsory. "Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give you light. You have died, and your life is hid with Christ in God. Awake, O sleeper. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on the earth. And Christ shall give you light. When Christ our life appears, you will appear with him in glory. Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give you light." We say the Benedictus. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who has come to his people and set them free. He has raised up for us a mighty Saviour, born of the house of his servant David. Through his holy prophets, God promised us of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all that hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors, and to remember his holy covenant. This was the oath God swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies. Free to worship him without fear, holy and righteous in his sight, all the days of our life. A new child shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of all their sins. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us, to shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Christian journey and pilgrimage,
and should also
encourage us to engage with the mission of the church.
Now, the gospel
passage of the parable of the servants and the talents is a very familiar one to many of us.
And many scholars over the years have looked at this in different ways, and there's, in a sense, probably a single interpretation, but many angles that you can come at it from. Of course, the first angle, in a sense, is that as Christians we are all called to be wise stewards, to use wisdom with the resources that we have. And certainly as we move into 2021, greatly tested, not only the church but probably all of us.
But what I'd like to focus on this morning is, in a sense, how this particular biblical passage from Matthew, and in a sense backed up by the encouragement we read in the first
letter to the Thessalonians, to in a sense engage
with
the mission of the church. But looking out to
nothing but empty pews. However, I stand here wondering if, in a sense, what I'm being given is a prophetic vision
of what will happen
to the church
if we don't take to heart
the teaching that we
find in this particular gospel passage, that indeed our pews and our churches will be empty and the church will lose any relevance in our society today.
It's interesting, in a sense, that the twist
on finances
that is in this gospel as well. And I did chuckle when I reread this earlier in the week, thinking about the servant that is giving one talent and his master's comment that he could invest it with the bank and have got some interest.
Well, clearly, when this
gospel passage was written,
the banks actually paid. Today. But the real focus of this is the fact that God has
a task for each and every one of us.
And
John Henry Newman, who was a leading figure in
the Oxford movement, which was in a sense a bit of a renaissance
of the Catholic tradition within the
Anglican Church. He was based
was involved in Christ
Church College in Oxford,
I was lucky enough while I was involved there to have dinner in one of the other colleges in Oxford where the people were
gathered to discuss
the work of the Oxford movement.
But
it's from Newman's Meditations and Devotions, some writings, a book he wrote in 1846.
And in this, Newman really believed that God has a particular
task for each and every one of us. And he wrote this: God has created me to do him some definite service.
God has created me to do him some definite service. And he goes on to say,
I shall never know it in this life,
but it shall be told
me in the next.
And that's worth
pondering. The fact that we are created in God's image and God has created us for a particular act of service in our lifetimes.
And this means that we need to pray and we
need to be familiar with
Scripture and we need to open our
hearts to the promptings of the Holy Spirit
and to be
led by God to do that possible task.
But Newman reminds us that
we may never know that we have actually done it until we are called by that final trumpet and gathered into that eternal kingdom, and then it will be revealed to us. And what I particularly like about this gospel passage is the fairness that you see within it.
The fact that it's possible for everybody to engage in the mission of the church and to have a particular task given to them by the Lord. Yes, indeed, the tasks
or number of tasks may differ depending on the particular gifts
and talents that we have also been given by God. As we see, there are, in a sense, three servants. One is given five talents, the other two, and one.
God gives to each of us a task that is matched to our ability.
And I think that's a really important thing, because it's a level playing field.
God is not expecting us to do more than he knows we possibly can.
So in that way,
we can all
be encouraged to be involved and
to take our part in building
God's kingdom, in sharing the good news, in engaging in the mission. And what's also
important is the reward is also the same.
So if we look at the first two servants, the one that receives the
five talents and the two talents, when they come back in a sense, they've doubled their money. Even though the servant who has
had five has made
10 talents, a lot more than the one who had two, their reward is exactly the same.
The master says
to both of them, "Well done, you trusted servant. You shall now be put in charge of greater things because you were able to deal with smaller things."
So in a sense, that symbolises that invitation into God's kingdom. And even though
the actual sort of monetary amount that each of those two servants has made is not the same, their reward is equal. They are both welcomed into that eternal kingdom, and that they will be trusted with more.
However,
when we then look at the servant who was given just the one talent, he is
afraid. And instead of
going out like the others have and investing it, taking a risk,
he decides the best thing to do is to bury it in the ground so that when his master returns,
he can return to him
what was given him.
Now, this for me is a really, really
important part of this gospel passage. Because what it is saying to us is that we must be prepared to take risks for the gospel. We must be
prepared, in a sense, to realise that we might
fail.
But we must be prepared and encouraged to take that risk and to go forward trusting in God.
And I fundamentally believe
this is one of the huge
problems and
barriers that the church faces today.
Because our church
institution, and it doesn't just have to be the
Church of England, is hugely risk averse. It doesn't like,
in a sense, taking chances.
It prefers not to
rock the boat. It prefers to keep things as they are and just to see if we can paddle along a little bit further, or, as I think the current phrase is, kick the can down the road a bit more. Mission is
about taking risks,
and that's why I love it, because I've always been a bit of a risk taker in my own life.
It's about the challenge.
It's about going forward. And it's about realising that we may actually fail. And believe me,
I failed
more times in mission than I have had successes. And in a sense, if you talk to any entrepreneurs, they will say a very similar thing. But what happens is you learn get up, you dust yourself down, you think about what needs to be done, and you have another go. And with my hat on as the rural field officer for Dorset, when I go around and I listen to stories of churches that, you know, in commas, are successful, and I don't mean successful just in the sense of having bums on pews in the congregation, successful in the sense that they are highly relevant to the communities
in which they are
based, that they really add something to that community life in the villages or towns where they are. What I have found time and time again is as I talk to the ordained ministers and the lay ministers of those churches, their church wardens and their PCCs, is that they are all prepared to take risks for the gospel. This is absolutely at the heart of mission. The opposite side of the coin is when I spend time with churches who are really, really struggling. And I sit with PCCs or their ordained or lay ministry teams. And ideas are suggested and we sort of chew the cud about what might happen. What I encounter time and time again is a whole list of excuses as to why we can't do that. They can range from, we've tried that umpteen times, to, we don't have the money, we don't have the people. The list goes on and on and on. But we need to be prepared to take risks for the gospel. And we need to place our trust in God and his Holy Spirit that he will direct us. And the evidence is absolutely loud and clear, if you look at it, in a sense where churches are growing in multiple ways, not just, as I say, having bums on seats, but actually, in a sense, really being relevant to the communities that they are in. So we must indeed be prepared to take those risks. But as I said, unfortunately, we have a system and a structure, and I do speak about the Church of England, that is often risk adverse and has become more and more so as the years have gone on. But let us look to those two servants who were prepared to go out and take that risk. And as we saw, they invested their talents and they doubled what they had and they were welcomed into God's kingdom. Now, just coming back to Newman and this idea that we have a particular task set for everyone. Now, sometimes we can feel particularly downhearted. We can feel as if maybe all that we have tried is really not making any difference. Or we can look at ourselves and think, what possible difference can I make in this world? Well, God isn't necessarily calling us as a single individual to change the world. God is calling us to help engage and build his kingdom where we are. And sometimes it's in those small differences that great things actually happen. It's sort of a bit like the ripple effect that some people talk about.
But we must be prepared to have a go.
And this is really important, not to be downhearted if we feel that things aren't necessarily going the way that we think they should. When I was ordained some 20 years ago, I was ordained with a lovely chap called Simon. And he went off to serve his curacy in what was quite a lively evangelical church in the diocese in which we served. He was a real man of God and was very spirit-filled. But as we got together as curates, to share our experiences, I noticed him becoming more and more downcast. And towards the end of his second year, as we all got together, he announced to us that he was going to leave
church.
Well, I remember speaking to him
that evening,
and I asked what had happened, whether he had lost his faith.
And the problem was,
it wasn't that he had lost his faith in God, he'd lost his faith in himself.
Because he had believed, he had, in a sense,
so much zeal for the Lord, so much energy and enthusiasm, that he
went into his curacy and went into this parish
church, believing that he was going to convert the whole of the town to the Christian faith. And 2 years on,
he hadn't done that. And he felt that he was a failure. And I remember saying to him at the time,
Simon, what you
probably don't realise is that God maybe
just has one specific task for you to undertake in your life.
Everything else that you do,
whether it's pastoral or missional or whatever it may be, and the successes that you may have, in a sense that is a bonus.
But there is one thing
that God will be asking of you in
your pilgrim journey. And as Newman
reminds us,
we won't necessarily know what it is. But it does mean that we have to pick up our pilgrim's
pack and our stick, and we have to walk that pilgrim road.
And we have to do it with faith, and like the disciples, go with that. And then,
when we are gathered together in God's eternal kingdom,
we will have it revealed to us, the task
that was set for us.
And then, and only then, will we know if we have accomplished it. Amen. In the Apostles' Creed. I believe in
God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in
Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead.
On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father.
Judge the living and the dead.
I believe in
the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
So let us pray
for the church and for the world. In prayer we
can uncover
God's will for our lives and find encouragement.
Let us come together
and present all our petitions at God's feet. We pray for each one of us gathered today,
for our friends,
family and colleagues,
particularly those who are
far from us, who we have not been able to see for some
time, for the strangers we meet on the streets.
Let us pray that we will be open opportunities we
have to transmit
God's grace and love to one another.
Lord,
in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We pray for our country
and political leaders,
for guidance
in this turbulent world,
particularly as we face
this pandemic.
Let us pray
that we will work together to rediscover our common morality, so that God's truth will prevail.
We
pray, Lord, for
all of those who work in our health service, for our doctors and nurses
and all
auxiliary staff. We pray especially today
for our local surgery here at Sixpenny Hanley. We pray too, Lord,
for the peoples of the US,
they find themselves in at this time.
afflictions that they have experienced may be healed, and those who are in positions of authority and responsibility will work towards healing them.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who feel
unmoored and rudderless, for ourselves when we feel we have no contribution to make, or are overshadowed by others. Let us pray that God will reveal which special talents and gifts we have been given, and how he wishes us to use them.
We pray especially, Lord, for all of those who are training for ministry,
both lay and ordained. We pray for the work of the Rural Hope team, and we pray for our deanery as it seeks to move forward and deal with the challenges of the future. Help us not to be afraid of the risks that we will need to take for that gospel message.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for people everywhere who are facing challenges that appear to be unsurmountable,
for those who are overwhelmed by what lies ahead, for those who feel lonely, helpless and frightened.
We pray especially at this time, Lord, for those who are worried about their financial futures, those who
are unemployed, those who find mortgages and rents that can't be paid, those who are worried for our young people,
for those particularly our way at university, finding things very
different from what they expected.
Let us pray that the Lord will grow close to them and in other people and encourage them on their journey. And Lord, we pray for all of those who suffer at this time.
We pray for those who are ill as a result of the coronavirus, for those who have had
other treatments delayed or postponed.
We pray for those who are struggling with mental health issues.
And we pray, Lord,
for all of those who are
working to bring this to an end. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. And Lord, we remember those. We are mindful of the
huge number, the 50 or more thousand people that have died as a result of this coronavirus. Mindful of their families and friends as they mourn at this time. And a personal prayer as I pray for Derek Jeans, who was my very first church warden in my first parish.
As he is gathered up unto the Lord,
we pray for his wife Marilyn.
Grant us with them a share in your eternal kingdom. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
And the collect for the second Sunday before Advent. Heavenly Father, whose blessed Son was revealed to destroy the works of the devil and to make us the children of God and heirs of eternal life,
grant that we, having this hope, may purify ourselves even as he is pure,
that when he shall appear in power and great glory,
we may be made like him in his eternal and glorious kingdom, where he is
alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever.
Amen.
Rejoicing in God's new creation,
let us pray as our Redeemer taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who
trespass against us. And lead us not into
temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory,
for ever and ever.
Amen.
So,
to Saturday, unless there's some emergency meeting that I need to attend in the morning. Next Sunday, as we're still in lockdown, the service will again be broadcast live from here at St Mary's, and notices will be given as to the type of service it will be as the week goes on. Of course, we can't have a collection today, and as I mentioned in my address, as all charities and organisations are finding this year particularly difficult. However, you can make a donation through the Golden Giving Scheme, which we've signed up to, and I will place a link on the church Facebook page after this service, which you can click on, and you can make a donation towards the work of our churches here at Handley and at Gussage. If you would like to make a specific donation to St Rumbold's Pentridge, then please contact me directly and I will pass you on to our Treasurer Richard at Pentridge.
Let us pray. The Lord bless us and preserve us from all evil and keep us in eternal life. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Let us join together in the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. And just to say that even though we can't gather collectively for worship, our churches at St Rumbold's Pentridge and here at St Mary's Handley, they are open during the day from around about 9 till 5 p.m. for private prayer and devotion. Here at Handley, of course, you can come in and light a candle if you wish. So please do feel free to use the church for your own personal prayer and reflection. But let's finish by singing our final hymn, picking up on all that we have thought about today, that we share in that work of proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ. Our final hymn, We Have a Gospel to
God bless everybody.